Where we have Dr. Pradeep from Shankarai Hospital, part of the Department of Vitro Retina, who's going to talk to us about a case that presents with floaters and decreased vision. Over to you, Pradeep.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, one and all. Yeah, in this presentation, I will be basically describing how to build a case of retina and how to reach to a diagnosis. In this case, it will be mainly a practical oriented, and I will be mainly discussing how you have to present and interpret a case in an exam. In this presentation, we will see a lot of abbreviations, but this is just for the convenience over here. But please make sure that you don't use any abbreviations in the exam. It is better to expand everything. Even the simple things like neovascularization and disc should be told as neovascularization and disc and not just an NVD. Okay. So we usually begin with an history. In this case, it's a 54-year-old gentleman, Mr. Muralidhar, who is a lecturer by occupation, who is a resident of Shimoga, who presented with the chief complaints of floaters in his left eye since 30 days. When you get this chief complaint, now we have to elaborate it in history of presenting illness. But what we should know is, like, first we should know what is a floater. We should understand that if patient has floater, that means he has some opacity in the vitreous which is moving. That is, there should be something in the vitreous cavity. So first we should know, like, what kind of floater it can be. So floaters can be sudden in onset, or they may be present for a longer duration. If it is sudden in onset, we have to know whether it is multiple small floaters or a single large floater. If it is multiple small floaters, it usually indicates the floater would be due to inflammatory cells in the vitreous, or it would be due to the vitreous hemorrhage. If it is a single large floater, it is more likely to be due to a Wiese ring secondary to the posterior vitreous detachment. When it is sudden and multiple small, we have to consider hemorrhage or inflammation. So hemorrhage, it can be due to a neovascularization elsewhere, a neovascularization at the disc. It can be due to a trauma where it can bleed from the large vessels, or it can be due to a retinal tear. The other floater would be due to inflammation. It will be usually seen in cases with posterior uveitis and in cases with iridocyclitis. If the floater is long standing, then it is mostly due to a degenerative changes in the vitreous, or it can be due to a chronic posterior uveitis. So we will elaborate based on this context. So in this patient, it's a patient complains of sudden onset multiple small floaters in his left eye, which was noted 30 days ago, which is almost similar since then. Then we have to ask about the associated symptoms. The associated symptom in this case, we should be more thinking about would be the blurred vision. So in this case, he says that there is an associated blurred vision, which was sudden in onset, which again was 30 days ago, and it is almost similar since then. So what is the relevance? So if a blurred vision occurs suddenly at the time of floaters, it can be mainly due to vitreous hemorrhage or the vitreous haze or vitritis. But the blurred vision occurs after a few days after the onset of floater, it can be due to a recurrent vitreous hemorrhage, and it can also be due to a retinal detachment. That is, a floater occurred due to a retinal tear, and after a few days, the patient developed retinal detachment and the patient developed blurred vision. Or it can be an inflammation, which would be responsible for floaters, but the inflammation has extended into the macula, which is leading to the blurred vision. Or it can be worsening of inflammation, which would be responsible for blurred vision. such as in the case of a retinitis or a choroiditis. Initially, it would be sparing the macula, so he would be complaining of floater. But once it involves the macula, he would be complaining of blurred vision. If the patient says that he has blurred vision since a long time and now it's a recent onset floater, we have to consider a pre-existing macular lesion, such as a macular edema or a macular ischemia due to vein occlusion or diabetic retinopathy, or a reactivation of an inflammatory sequel. His poor vision, which was long-standing, would be due to a old scar at the macula due to a retinitis or choroiditis. And now the new onset floater can be due to a reactivation of the inflammation. So in this case, the patient says that he had sudden onset multiple small floaters and blurred vision, which occurred together at around 30 days back. So we should consider vitreous hemorrhage or inflammation as a differential diagnosis. So the possibilities would be vitreous hemorrhage, which can be due to a retinal tear, a neovascularization at disc or elsewhere, or trauma, or it can be due to an inflammation, particularly posterior uveitis or iodocyclitis. Now, our negative history should be in accordance to rule out each of these. So, negative history we should take to rule out a retinal tear, to rule out vitreous hemorrhage, to rule out uveitis. So, vitreous hemorrhage due to tear, then there is a possibility that the patient will also have flashes if there is retinal detachment which is already developing. The patient may have field effect, or the patient may be a myopic and would be using a glasses since long time. So we need to ask about that. In our case, there is no history of flashes or field effect, but the patient is using spectacles for near vision since 10 years, but there is no history of using high powered glasses since childhood. Then vitreous hemorrhage can also be due to trauma, so we should ask about trauma. In this case, there is no history of trauma. The other thing, as I already mentioned, would be uveitis. So we need to ask about pain and redness, but it will be present only in iridocyclitis. Posterior uveitis usually does not have pain or redness. So in this case, we need to ask about history of pain, redness, or photophobia, which is absent in this case. The other thing we should ask is whether there is any history of similar complaints in other eye, because inflammation or diabetic retinopathy usually affects both the eye. Then we will go to the past history. Again, in this, we should be asking history which is relevant to rule out a retinal tear, vitreous hemorrhage, or uveitis. So vitreous hemorrhage due to a neovascularization at the disc or elsewhere may present with recurrent episodes. Similarly, uveitis will have recurrent episodes. And if this is an episode of posterior uveitis, there is a possibility that earlier the patient had an episode of iridocyclitis and would have had pain or redness. So we should ask about history of similar episodes in the past with recovery. So in this case, there is no such history. Then coming to the treatment history, again, we have to ask in such a way that we are thinking in terms of one of the three differentials. So if it's a retinal tear, there's a possibility that the patient would have undergone laser. So we should ask about the history of laser. If it's due to a neovascularization elsewhere or neovascularization of the disc due to a vein occlusion or a diabetic retinopathy, we should ask about laser or injections. If it is uveitis, there is a possibility that the patient would have been treated with oral steroids or an injection, for example, intravitreal injections or posterior subtenon injections or peribulbar injections. So we should ask about history of laser treatment or injection or oral medications in the past, which is absent in this case. Then systemic history pertaining to these. So if we think of vitreous hemorrhage due to a diabetic retinopathy or a vein occlusion, we should ask about diabetes mellitus and hypertension. And we should ask about the duration and the current status. In this patient, the patient gives history of diabetes mellitus since 23 years and is on oral medication with good systemic control. Patient also gives an history of hypertension since 20 years and is on medication with good systemic control. Considering uveitis being one more differential, we need to ask about history of joint pain, breathlessness, cough, or oral ulcers, which is not there in this case. In cases with diabetes mellitus and hypertension, it is always better to know about the renal and cardiac status. So in this case, there is no history of renal or cardiac disease. Coming to family history, as such, family history would be relevant in cases with retinal tear and retinal detachment, as familial predisposition is known in retinal detachment. So we can ask about family history of RD or retinal surgery, which is not there in this particular case. Personal history, again pertaining to this particular case, we need to ask about history of smoking, which would be a risk factor for vein occlusion and even progression of diabetic retinopathy. So in this case, patient is not a smoker or an alcoholic. So based on this, we will analyze the history. So patient complains of sudden onset floaters and blurred vision. He is a known diabetic and hypertensive with no history of pain, redness or photophobia. The possible differential diagnosis at this age would be a PDR with vitreous hemorrhage, a vein occlusion with vitreous hemorrhage, a posterior vitreous detachment with vitreous hemorrhage due to a retinal tear, or it can also be due to a posterior uveitis. So we will describe the general physical examination and systemic examination. I will just skip through this now. Coming to the ocular examination, we should, in whatever case it may be, we have to go through systematically. Sometimes the examiners may ask for a relevant positive findings, then you can skip to the positive findings alone. In this case, the head posture is normal, the ocular annulment is orthophoric, facial symmetry, the facial features are symmetrical, the ocular movements are full and free. You need to describe these in detail in case of oculoplasty or squint. But in a retinal case, you would be just describing a crucial points only. Coming to the ocular examination, conventionally we describe right eye first, then we describe the left eye. Coming to the visual acuity, the uncorrected distance vision in the right eye is 6/6 and the best corrected vision is 6/6. The near vision with +3 diopter is N6. In left eye, the uncorrected visual acuity is 6/18. But there is no improvement with pinhole. And the near vision is N10 with +3 diopter. As I already mentioned, conventionally you describe right eye completely, then you describe left eye. But for the ease of this presentation, I am completing both simultaneously. Coming to the ocular examination again, the lids and adnexa are normal in both the eye. Rhoplas is negative in both the eye. Conjunctiva is normal in both the eyes. Coming to the ocular examination, continuing with the ocular examination, in the right eye, the cornea is clear, the anterior chamber depth is normal and quite. Iris, the color and pattern of the iris is normal. We should specifically mention about NVI when we are suspecting it to be a case of proliferative diabetic retinopathy or vein occlusion. So we have to mention whether there is any NVI or not. And again, pupillary reactions become very important. We need to see whether the pupil is round, regular, and then we have to see about the light reflex, both the direct and consensual light reflex. In this case, it is brisk in both the eyes. The lens grade is nuclear sclerosis grade 1. As I already mentioned, NVI is something very important we have to see. This is how an NVI would look like. You will see like the dilated vessels and irregular branching of these vessels will be usually seen, and initially it starts at the pupillary margin. So we have to carefully look at the pupillary margin with the high magnification, preferably 25x. So if we see over here, if you see an NVI, we have to draw it in this way. Then we will move on to the fundus examination. Fundus examination of the right eye. First, we mentioned about distant direct ophthalmoscopy. This, there is a red glow. On fundus examination with indirect ophthalmoscopy with 20D and slit lamp biomicroscopy with 90D, we have to describe. What we have to do is, we have to see the posterior pole in detail with 90D with slit lamp. Then we have to move on to 20D for the indirect ophthalmoscopy. As I already mentioned, one of the differential in this case would be a retinal tear. So it is always better to say a thorough peripheral examination with indentation was performed. Okay. So coming to media, in the right eye, the media is clear. The optic disc is normal in size, vertically oval with well-defined margin. Cup disc ratio is 0.1:1. The neuroretinal rim is healthy. This is due to the brightness of the picture. You are seeing it to be a bit pale, but as such, the neuroretinal rim in this case was healthy. Then we will talk about the vessels. The vessels arising from the disc are normal with an arteriovenous ratio of 2:3. The foveal reflex is normal. Then we will talk about the background. In this case, what we see are, we see multiple red dot intraretinal hemorrhages, which are predominantly located in temporal to macula. We see a streak of preretinal hemorrhage along the inferotemporal arcade. Then we describe about these. You can see an irregular network of vessels noted in supranasal to fovea and superior to disc, suggestive of flat neovascularization elsewhere. The neovascularization elsewhere located supranasal to fovea is larger than 1 disc diameter, and the one superior to disc is 1 disc diameter in size. We need to mention about the size of NVE in a case of PDR, as we all know that the high risk characteristic is defined based on the size of neovascularization at the disc and neovascularization elsewhere. Again, here we can see that there are whitish preretinal lesions overlaying the large caliber vessels along the superotemporal arcade and the inferotemporal arcade, suggestive of fibrous proliferation. Now we need to draw it. There is a presentation by Dr. Divyansh in a channel by Shankara Academy of Vision. You can go through the retinal diagram presentation once again if you have missed it. So here I will be just discussing about this particular case. Here we can see that here it's the flat NVE I mentioned. So you draw them with orange. Most of the clinicians would use a red colored pencil to describe this, but if you go through Payman, the traditional description in Payman is an orange color for the flat NVE. So it's better to draw with something which you can quote a reference. So in this case, you can see that there is a flat NVE. So I have represented them in orange. Then you have a preretinal fibrous tissue, which has to be drawn with a hatched lines. Then hemorrhages will be represented with red. In this case, the patient also had inferior vitreous hemorrhage, so I have represented it with green. The preretinal hemorrhage or the subhyoid hemorrhage will be shown with red, whereas the vitreous hemorrhage would be shown with green. So coming to the left eye, in this case, the distant direct ophthalmoscopy shows red glow. Again, the fundus examination with the indirect ophthalmoscopy with 20D and slit lamp biomicroscopy with 90D shows a hazy media due to vitreous hemorrhage. Even though your media is not clear, you have to mention it in a systematic way. For example, we will next talk about disc. The optic disc is seen, but the details of the disc is hazy due to vitreous hemorrhage. It appears normal in size. Vessels in the visible areas appear normal. Foveal reflex is not appreciated due to poor visibility. In the visible retina, we can see dot red intraretinal hemorrhages, particularly in the temporal macula. Again, coming to the fundus diagram, in this case, it's vitreous hemorrhage which is seen. So we'll draw with a green. In this case, due to poor visibility, we are not seeing neovascularization at the disc or elsewhere. It would be hidden behind the vitreous hemorrhage. So I will just describe how to describe typical findings in diabetic retinopathy. In this case, we had a few findings. The other findings which are not seen in this case, I will just tell how to describe them. Because example, if you see this, you know that this is a cottonal spot, but you need to describe that lesion to say that it is a cottonal spot. You can't just say that it's a cottonal spot. So what you will say that there is a slightly elevated white patch with fluffy edges along the superotemporal arcade suggestive of Cottonelle spots. Similarly, this particular one, there are multiple small waxy yellow deposits with sharp margins suggestive of hard exudates in a serginate pattern located temporal to fovea. Here, you describe it as a retinal thickening at fovea with presence of cystoid spaces. You can make out that there are these round spaces you can see. So it's a retinal thickening at fovea with presence of cystoid spaces suggestive of cystoid macular edema. In some cases, you may have a typical petaloid appearance. Then you can mention about the petaloid appearance also. If there are no cysts, you can just mention retinal thickening at the fovea suggestive of macular edema. Then coming to the intraocular pressure and gonioscopy. Intraocular pressure in the right eye was 16 mm of mercury and left eye was 14 mm of mercury. Gonioscopy showed open angles. Ciliary body band was visualized in all the quadrants. You need to specifically mention about presence of neovascularization at the angle in this particular case, considering that it's a case of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So you should mention that there is no neovascularization at the angle. If it's there, you have to mention it. So diagnosis, so the most important thing would be, like, many a times the examiner would not be able to listen to your entire presentation. So they will ask you to summarize the case. That is something which is very important. I will just tell you, like, how to summarize a case. In this case, we can say like this: a 54-year-old gentleman with a long-standing history of diabetes mellitus and hypertension presented with sudden onset multiple small floaters and blurred vision since 30 days. On examination, the visual acuity in right eye is 6/6 and 6/18 in the left eye. Anterior segment examination is unremarkable. There is no neovascularization at the iris. Fundus examination of the right eye shows multiple dot hemorrhages, preretinal fibrous proliferation, neovascularization elsewhere larger than 1 disc diameter in size with a streak preretinal hemorrhage and vitreous hemorrhage. Fundus examination of the left eye shows multiple dot hemorrhages and vitreous hemorrhage. So my diagnosis would be a right eye proliferative diabetic retinopathy with high risk characteristic with no macular edema, left eye vitreous hemorrhage. In this case, like, we did not see any neovascularization because of vitreous hemorrhage. So you can say that it is possibly due to PDR considering the other eye characteristic. So why high risk characteristic in this case? Because you can see that the definition of high risk characteristic include neovascularization at disc, which is more than 1/3 disc area, any NVD with vitreous hemorrhage, or NVE more than half disc area with vitreous hemorrhage. As I mentioned, our case has an NVE which is larger than 1 disc size and has vitreous hemorrhage in the right eye. So it's a high risk characteristic. So it's always better to classify diabetic retinopathy according to the International Clinical Diabetic Retinopathy Classification. This is just a table mentioning the ICDR classification. ETDRS classification is quite complex and it was actually designed for study purpose. So it is difficult to use it in clinical practice. So you can use the International Clinical Diabetic Retinopathy Classification. Then coming to the management of this particular case, any case of diabetic retinopathy, we always have to start our management with systemic evaluation. Even in case with vein occlusion, we need to first describe systemic evaluation to rule out the risk factors for vein occlusion. In this case, we have to know about the glycemic control. So we get an HbA1c level. We have to know about the hypertension status. We get a BP done. We have to rule out hyperlipidemia, renal failure, and anemia. So we get lipid profile, a renal function test, and hemoglobin. These are the minimum investigations that we need to do in every case of diabetic retinopathy because we have to rule out the systemic risk factors. If the systemic risk factors are not under control, we should ensure the control of the systemic risk factors before proceeding with treatment of eye itself. Ocular investigation in this case, which is relevant, would be fundus fluorescein angiography. The advantage of doing a fundus fluorescein angiography in this case would be in the right eye, you will be able to identify the capillary non-perfusion areas, and in the left eye, you will be able to see if there is any NVE or NVD, which we could not appreciate due to vitreous hemorrhage. NVD may be difficult to visualize this in this case because the vitreous hemorrhage would hamper the visualization through fundus fluorescent angiography. So as our diagnosis for the right eye is proliferative diabetic retinopathy with high risk characteristic, we have to manage that. So management depends based on the presence of macular edema or absence. If there is macular edema, we have to treat the macular edema first. Then we have to treat the neovascularization elsewhere or neovascularization at disc with pan-retinal photocoagulation. Because if we proceed with pan-retinal photocoagulation first, it may lead to worsening of macular edema. So first we describe about management of the macular edema. Then we go ahead with pan-retinal photocoagulation. Usually it's just like the, if it's a center involving diabetic macular edema, preferably you start with an intravitreal anti-VEGF, and once the edema subsides, maybe around 10 to 14 days, we may plan pan-retinal photocoagulation. And again, the edema would recur and we have to continue treatment for macular edema. In this case, there is no macular edema in the right eye, so we can proceed with pan-retinal photocoagulation directly. Coming to the left eye, the patient has a vitreous hemorrhage due to proliferative diabetic retinopathy. In cases with vitreous hemorrhage, most important would be to know the duration of vitreous hemorrhage. If it is a recent onset one, you can observe for vitreous hemorrhage and you can plan pan-retinal photocoagulation in visible areas. But if it's a long-standing one and if it's compromising the vision, then we will consider doing vitrectomy in such cases. In the present case, it's a recent onset vitreous hemorrhage. It's around 1 month. And as I already mentioned, the fundus predominantly is visible. Only the inferior part of the retina and the posterior pole is not seen. So in this case, we will observe for vitreous hemorrhage. At the same time, we'll plan a pan-retinal photocoagulation in the visible areas. So one thing you should have noticed is that I describe both eyes simultaneously, but in exams, preferably complete the right eye examination completely, then go to the left eye, okay? Thank you. If there are any questions, I would try to answer them.
So Dr. Pradeep, in any patient who presents with a case of a floater with decreased vision, what are the most common errors that you find students make in terms of the way they describe the diagnosis?
The most common mistake I usually find is when anyone hears the word floaters, the first thing they think would be retinal detachment. So they will be talking more in terms of retinal detachment rather than other things. But floater can be due to any reason, as I already mentioned. Floater is just indicative of some opacity in the vitreous, which can be due to any cause. This is something which we commonly see. When we tell the word floater, if the patient complains of floaters, the first thing they think is retinal detachment. So retinal detachment is one of the differential. That is if retinal detachment develops due to a retinal tear and the retinal tear had some vitreous hemorrhage, then the patient will have floaters. That is one thing. And when we take the negative history, many a times what everyone does is they conventionally tell about a few things. They keep telling about trauma, use of glasses, or pain, redness. This is something everyone tells. But before telling them whether it is relevant to the case or not, whether it is helping you to reach to a specific diagnosis or not, this is very important. As I was discussing, most of my history, even my development of the history in history of presenting illness or the negative history, the family history, personal history, the past history, the treatment history, everything was pertaining to rule out or confirm one of our differential. It should not be a random history, conventionally not asking everything is not required. You have to taper it to the chief complaint, because you will not be knowing the diagnosis at the beginning. With this case could have been retinal detachment also, but you should be asking negative history to rule out a few conditions which you are thinking based on the chief components.
So assuming that there is a, like you described in this particular case, where there's a patient who's come and you finally diagnose it to be a vitreous hemorrhage secondary to a PDR, how should the student describe the diagnosis, or as an examiner, what all would you expect him to include as a part of the diagnosis when he presents?
Yeah, as I mentioned here, like this is something which I would like to say, we have to tell about the stage of diabetic retinopathy. Here it's proliferative diabetic retinopathy with high risk characteristic. And as I already mentioned, macular edema is something we have to mention in any case of diabetic retinopathy. Even if it's a moderate non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, I would expect to say like whether the patient has macular edema or no macular edema. If the patient has macular edema, again, at least based on the ICDR classification, whether it is mild, moderate, severe, that has to be mentioned, because our management depends based on this. So at least these things have to be covered. Some people may even expect you to tell about the systemic condition, like the status of systemic control, but not everyone would expect that. But at least you should be able to mention about the stage of diabetic retinopathy and the status of macular edema. And if there is any significant cataract or significant other finding, you may have to mention it.
I think what you pointed out is very important, saying that if there is an associated cataract or any other ocular pathology, don't get fixated with the diagnosis that you found first. And I think it's important for students to remember to document all the other findings as a part of the findings and also as a part of the diagnosis. I think that becomes a very important caveat. Again, Pradeep, you've been part of as an expert for multiple exams. Typically in cases of when they're examining the retina, what are the tests that you find students often forget to do? Like, for example, I've often found them forget to do an upline-nation tonometry or measure the IOP. So what are those things that they should always kind of have a checklist in mind, saying that I should not forget these tests?
Yeah, as sir rightly pointed out, what are some of the tests we should never forget in a retinal case would be, one is upline-nation tonometer, and another thing would be gonioscopy. These two are very important. We should not miss them. And there are a few specific tests pertaining to specific diseases. For example, if the patient has a metamorphopsia, it's always better to do an Amsler's test. If the patient has scotoma, then it's better to do an Amsler's test, because most of the examiners would expect them. So if your history or if your examination shows anything which can result in metamorphopsia or a central scotoma kind of a picture, make sure that you get an Amsler's test done in all those cases. And as I mentioned, if it's a retinal detachment which you are suspecting, a peripheral indentation and peripheral screening is something which would be expected. I don't say that everyone will be able to screen the periphery completely in every patient, but you should always make an attempt to do a peripheral examination with indentation, particularly when the patient is complaining of floater. That becomes very important. Many a people would skip this particular step. If someone suddenly asks you, did you do a peripheral examination with indentation, then it will strike your mind. So always keep in your mind to consider it as your examining. You mention it that you did this and could not identify any peripheral break or any peripheral lesion, particularly in a case of retinal detachment or any case with floaters with vitreous hemorrhage. As I already mentioned, in the left eye, we don't know whether there's an NVE or an NVD. There is a possibility that the patient would have developed a retinal tear, and because of retinal tear, he would have vitreous hemorrhage. Just that he is a case of a PDR in one eye doesn't say that he may not develop a PVD-related tear in the other eye. It is definitely possible. So we always have to mention about the peripheral screening with indentation, particularly if the symptoms are flashes, floaters, and if it's a vitreous hemorrhage or it is a retinal detachment.
There are a couple of questions from the YouTube stream. I think it's more pertaining to management. However, I think it'd be nice if you can answer.
Sure,
the first question is, in a case of floaters with vitreous liquefaction, what would you do?
Yeah, as I already mentioned, like vitreous liquefaction or degenerative changes related floaters would be long standing, and most of the times they are self-resolving and the symptoms would come down over time. So we usually observe them. Floaterectomy is something like which is a vitrectomy for floaters, which would be considered very rarely if the patient is extremely symptomatic, and if the floaters are quite a lot, then only we consider vitrectomy for floaters. But if you ask me, like for a DNB exam perspective, don't even consider telling a floaterectomy or a vitrectomy for floaters. Most of the times we just observe them because there's nothing which needs to be done. Most of the times it's a reassurance which is required, with which the patient would find better and it would improve over time. Some people may have them for long standing, but it is just a reassurance which is actually more important.
I think the second question seems to be a lot more personal. It's a question, again, I'm taking it only because we are focusing on postgraduates. So this is a case where they're asking, saying a medical student of 32 years with a sudden floater, when he's concentrating more to study, whether it can be treated. So I guess this is a question of probably a blind spot versus a floater.
First, the most important thing is like we need to know whether it's a scotoma or a floater. Floater definitely moves. It won't be constant in the visual field, whereas scotoma is something which is specific, which is usually seen in a fixed position in visual field. So if it's a scotoma, it needs a thorough evaluation to see like what is the cause. If it's a floater, then as I mentioned, it doesn't usually require treatment. Like particularly like if a 32-year-old and there is floaters, what we do a thorough peripheral examination. We see if there is any treatable lesion in the periphery, if there is any retinal hole, if there is any lattice, we see that once. And second thing is like we have to rule out, is there any posterior uveitis, but or an intermediate uveitis. That is something which we have to see. If there is no objective lesion, if there is no lesion or on clinical examination, it can be just ignored. As even I have floaters in my left eye, like which is present since a lot more days, but there is no lesion. So it's just that a reassurance, and just ignoring it is what is more important. But a thorough examination to rule out any cause is very important. Sir, any other questions, sir?
So I think that's pretty much it, Pradeep. So thank you so much. Again, I would encourage those who are watching this stream to go through the rest of the videos on this channel. Also, feel free to post any specific tests or specific cases that leaves you a little confused. We will see if we can upload any videos on it. I think, again, we have another input that's come in on the chat saying that checking for RAPD and the confrontation test for field may also have a significant value in a retinal examination. So again, students, please do not get sidelined looking at a particular finding. Make sure that you do a complete diagnosis and then look at it. I would take this opportunity to let the postgraduates listening on the stream know that we are conducting, as a part of our Shankara Academy of Vision, a four-day workshop on research methodology. You could again look it up on our Facebook feed. You will find it. This is going to be conducted over 2 weekends. Starting from tomorrow evening between 6:30 to 8:30. We have very eminent research specialists who have worked extensively in the field of ophthalmology who are going to be guiding us. This is meant for postgraduates who are working on their thesis, either to write their protocols or to be able to write their entire dissertation. So this will give you a basic, it will help you strengthen your fundamentals about research. So do write in to us or reach us out on any of our social media handles and we will get the information to you. We are limiting registrations to 40 candidates to keep it interactive. So once again, thank you so much for being part of the stream today. And we look forward to engaging with you going ahead. To those preparing for your exams, we wish you the very best.
Thank you, sir. All the best for